Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all Denarians on the go and in the know. Like, subscribe, and share to help support the channel. First article of interest for today: after the collapse of oil prices and the decline in the entry of hard currency into Iraq, a difference of opinion. Will Iraq face Lebanon's fate in the collapse of the currency? Will the dinar collapse against the dollar? The Iraqi street, especially the commercial and real estate circles, is witnessing a state of intense fear and fear as a result of the drop in oil prices and the decline in the entry of hard currency into Iraq, which threatens the collapse of the dinar against the dollar and confront the fate as Lebanon's fate and its national currency. Experts on economic affairs differed in opinions on this issue. Some of them assured the people of the strength of the dinar against the dollar, and some of them put the ball in the court of the government and its strength in the face of this crisis. This is what was stated by the economist, Rod Twigg, who emphasized, "The Iraqi dinar is a good store of purchasing power." Twigg said in a statement to Nina, "The Iraqi citizen has become increasingly concerned about the possibility of the devaluation of the Iraqi currency after losing part or all of the country's main resource of the dollar. In fact, the Iraqi dinar may decline but to certain levels and not to low levels, as is the case with the Lebanese currency." He pointed out, "The Iraqi dinar is a good store for purchasing power and is based on cash reserves in the central bank worth $60 billion, and then the reduction of imports and their immediate cessation except for necessities such as food and medicine, with central control and state control, and there is nothing wrong with declaring the state of economic emergency and punishing speculators in the Iraqi dinar or the smuggling of the dollar or money laundering and fighting the formation of multiple exchange numbers and the black market for the currency. All these measures will prevent the Iraqi currency from slipping to low levels of value." Coronation called on the government to be cautious in hedging, pointing out the importance of the role of the central bank by adopting a rational monetary policy, and the fine of leaving a margin for currency movement for the purposes of secure monetary expansion, stressing, "The oil and financial crisis will not continue for a long period of time." On its effectiveness in continuing rational lending expansion, encouraging local production and expanding real production in Iraq as one of the alternatives for the importer, which will maintain the monetary cycle. Twigg noted that one of the ways to support the Iraqi dinar is to invest human and material resources inside Iraq and turn the current situation into a strengthening factor for the Iraqi economy. "The Iraqi economy is a dollar economy and cannot afford any economic tremors." And Safwan Qusay, the expert in the economic affairs, did not differ greatly from his colleague Twigg in his opinion, but he held the government the greatest responsibility in the collapse of the local currency, saying, "The financial and economic stability of Iraq depends on the ability of the Iraqi government is to remain in the balance zone between the American and Iranian conflict, so strict measures must be taken to comply with the requirements of the American Treasury and spare Iraq to enter the U.S. sanctions zone. Other than that, the Iraqi economy is a dollar economy and will not be able to bear any U.S. sanctions." Qusay stressed in a statement to Nina, "Iraq can play a role in being a window to the Iranian economy by opening a joint account for humanitarian needs with the possibility of allowing the flow of goods purchased in the Iraqi dinar to benefit Iran, under the supervision of the supervisory authorities in the Central Bank of Iraq and Integrity." He explained that Iraq will not face the fate of Lebanon regarding the issue of currency collapse, because Iraq has resources and the Iraqi central bank has acceptable proportions that are able to cover the currency within the procedures, even with oil revenues stopping for at least 8 months to come. He explained that what happened in Lebanon is that individuals deposited foreign currencies in commercial banks, which in turn deposited them with the central bank, which paid these money debts to the Lebanese government, adding that when the crisis occurred and individuals demanding their dues, the banks did not find liquidity and the Central Bank of Lebanon could not pay receivables in dollars and facilitated the process of paying in Lebanese pounds, which led to raising the exchange rate of the dollar from 1,500 pounds to more than 4,000 Lebanese pounds. It is noteworthy that the head of the Parliamentary Finance Committee, Haitham Al-Juberi, confirmed earlier that Iraq has been unable for some days to sell its oil because of the suspension of factories and companies around the world due to the repercussions of the coronavirus crisis. The Finance Committee submitted a set of proposals to be taken in the face of the crisis of low oil prices, or to reduce its severity. Member of the Parliamentary Finance Committee, Faisal Al-Issawi, said that there are proposals submitted by the committee to overcome the crisis of low oil prices, in conjunction with the outbreak of the new coronavirus and its impact on economic activities. He indicated that there are several tracks that were presented, such as controlling border crossings, following up the great waste in oil refineries and how to benefit from the monetary bloc in banks and the central bank, and perhaps going towards international financial institutions to borrow. He believed that the current government will not be able to take a decision or discuss the proposals, and it may be up to the new government. Between the hammer and the anvil, the Iraqi citizen lives a state of anticipation and panic over the current situation and the fate of the dinar in the coming days. Next article of interest. The website of the Iraq Stock Exchange has stopped working. The website of the Iraq Stock Exchange stopped working today and during the past days. Today, Sunday, Al Mustaqila correspondent said that he tried to enter the market's website, but his efforts were unsuccessful, stressing that he tried to enter for the purpose of extracting information about the banking sector. He added that the site has been out of operation since last Thursday. It is mentioned that most of the websites of state institutions are either not working or they do not meet the technical requirements for the work of websites. Next article of interest. Central bank digital currencies, changing the architecture of money. Traditional finances could be dramatically changed in the near future, and central bank issued digital currency is the first step. Once a niche enthusiasm with the launch of Bitcoin, BTC, digital money powered by blockchain technology has matured rapidly in just a few short years. The market is now highly diverse. For example, audited stable coins, along with fixed-use digital cash projects introduced by Wells Fargo and JP Morgan last year, stand in stark contrast to cryptocurrencies that fluctuate as much as 10% a day. The ultimate sign of graduation from the margins into the mainstream, however, is perhaps the way that central banks are now embracing the technology. Central bank digital currencies are now in active pilot programs by many central banks across the world. The People's Bank of China has embarked on its own digital yuan project, and Sweden's central bank, Sveriges Riksbank, has announced a pilot for a digital version of its currency for retail use, dubbed the e-krona. Additionally, the United States Federal Reserve, the Bank of England, the Bank of Japan and the European Central Bank are all currently exploring the technology. Meanwhile, the Bank for International Settlements, the so-called Central Bank Central Bank, has been discussing CBDCs at length and recently forecasted that amid the current global pandemic, contaminated bills may be the catalyst for central banks to deliver a digital cash alternative for payments. Why else are central banks, the heart of the economic establishment, so interested in technology with such radical and revolutionary roots? In part, they have been responding to challenges from private sector initiatives, such as Facebook's Libra. However, CBDCs also potentially offer substantial benefits for general purpose use, which make them highly attractive in their own right. Specifically, central banks' motivations include providing a cash alternative, promoting financial inclusion, increasing signia-rich profit, the difference between the currency's face value and the cost of its production and distribution, implementing monetary policy, linking payments to identity, modernizing payments for a digital economy. What's interesting about the recent models is the collaborative approach many have been taking with a supporting cast from the private sector. For example, the Bank of England has been researching what it calls the platform model, in which the bank is the only entity allowed to create or destroy a token, while leaving payment interface providers to interact with end users. The proposal gives PIPS the responsibility to maintain know-your-customer checks, while providing them with the freedom to differentiate themselves by providing additional services on top of the core payments. Others have gone a step further. Researchers at the IMF have recently coined the term synthetic CBDC to describe a model in which a non-central bank entity, such as a commercial bank, can issue a stable coin backed by central bank reserves. Ultimately, we are likely to see a variety of uses for CBDCs in the retail space and a number of different implementations. These will have important benefits for a wide variety of institutions, from corporate treasury departments to payment networks open to the general public. We have been witnessing the distinction quickly blurring between the currently evolving retail CBDC models and previous projects with wholesale CBDCs. We have already learned that a CBDC is a great tool at the wholesale level, and its applications can teach us a lot about the prospects for retail CBDCs. For example, Project Ubin with the Monetary Authority of Singapore has taught us that a blockchain-enabled CBDC supports more efficient complex payment workflows, including a decentralized liquidity savings mechanism. Project Jasper with the Bank of Canada and the Canadian Stock Exchange have taught us that a blockchain-based CBDC leads to operational improvements such as 24/7 access to the payment system and T+0 settlement more effectively than existing financial market infrastructures can provide. Project Infinin with the Bank of Thailand and the Hong Kong Monetary Authority have taught us that a blockchain-based CBDC allows for a cross-border corridor. It has enabled FX price discovery, and has facilitated atomic B2P. Blockchain technology is crucial in enabling the tokenization of these payment assets, allowing for peer-to-peer transactions and distributed custody. Additionally, blockchain tech enables atomic transactions, which means that any delivery versus payment or PEP scenario can occur, in real time, without the risk that one leg of the transaction will be executed before the other. Blockchain technology also sets the architecture for a more secure payment system, in which there is no centralized point of failure nor honeypot for hackers to attack. Finally, it allows connectivity into a growing tokenized financial ecosystem with global integrity. Looking forward, we can imagine a completely new architecture for money in the near future, which will, in many ways, be a significant change to the nature of money as the invention of the credit card. This architecture is enabled by blockchain technology as a system of record and relies on central banks' diligence in providing robust governance frameworks for these new assets. Widespread access to CBDCs will be key for central banks to fulfill their mandate of offering modern payment solutions. Additionally, it will catalyze the connectivity among the general public, corporations and the financial industry, with parallel innovations currently being built out by firms leveraging blockchain technology in non-payment related areas. Central banks have a tremendous opportunity to orchestrate and provide purchasing power into this ecosystem. Like, subscribe and share to help support the channel. Check out the Denarian blog, Facebook and Twitter, as I post important daily updates on these platforms throughout the day as well. The links to these and other invaluable sites are in the description box below. Knowledge is power. Using that knowledge is powerful. Over and out for now, the Denarian.